It is indeed my pleasure to introduce Professor John Mathew. John Mathew is an associate professor at Krea. I've forgotten now like which actual discipline he is in. He teaches across disciplines at Krea. He has taught all the way from anthropology to theater to biology. And he's one of the few faculty members, I think, at Krea who has actually taught across all the three divisions. In fact, I think one of his courses is cross-discipline, across all divisions, all the way from literature and arts to humanities and social sciences to the division of sciences, and that's science, history, and theater. So John is also unique in another way. Unlike most of us non-achievers, John has two PhDs. One is not enough for him. He got his first PhD from the Old Dominion University in ecology, which brings him close to my heart. And the second one he got from Harvard University in the history of science. So John, mainly right now he's working, and John, do correct me if I'm wrong, on the influenza and the plague pandemics in India from a historical perspective. But he's also right in the process of publishing his book, which is To Fashion a Fauna for British India. And we're really hoping that we'll all be able to read that book very, very soon. So in the midst of all of this busy teaching and research schedule, John also finds time to work very intensively in both music and art. He works with a large number of artists. Thank you so much, Deva. Both within Krea and outside Krea. With no further ado, John Mathew.
Thank you very much, Duha. That's very kind. It's a delight to see all of you. I was part of the initial contingent that taught SCR in 2019, and it's great to be back and to see all of you. I was asked to speak about the history of science, and so I thought it might be fruitful to discuss this topic, why history matters for science. And I'm not going to take every last example that I possibly can. What I do will be illustrative, but hopefully it will make the point. Let's see where we are. Okay. So let's start with someone you may have read, maybe. How do I move this? Why is this not moving? Frozen. Oh. Okay, yeah, cool. All right, William Shakespeare, right? So you've all done William Shakespeare in school, I take it? In some form or the other? Yeah, okay. How many of you have seen this movie, Shakespeare in Love? That's dating people, isn't it? Yeah, okay. Okay, let me see. My thing is stuck. I don't know why. Should I pull this out? So now it'll work. Can I close this?
No, sir.
See, now it's working. Okay, let me see if I can do this. Okay, put this back. I don't need that. Is that playing? No, let's see. All right, so this is the last scene from Shakespeare in Love. And I'll tell you why I'm bringing Shakespeare in shortly. Yeah. Volume? Hello? Okay. So you've got Sir Francis Bacon, and he writes a very important book called The Novum Organon, in which it's a second part of what he calls the Instauratio Magna, right? And what he's fundamentally doing is two things. One, he's trying to reaffirm, right? That's great. What happened? Yeah. Oh.
No, sir, the screen said.
It was? I said. One second. I shared it before.
Mm-hmm.
Sir. I shared it before. Okay. All right. All right.
Zoom in.
It's got to be a echo again.
Zoom in.
Yes. Okay. May I close this? Is that fine now? Can
yes.
I do that?
Yes.
Okay, fine. All right. So we've got this. What he's doing is two things. One, he's trying to place again humankind, or what he would call mankind in his time. Now what? let me try this. Put this back again. Hopefully this will work. It's back? Okay. Now the question is, am I still sharing screen? I hope I am. Yeah, cool. All right. Cool. All right. So so one thing he's doing is he's affirming the place of humankind's superiority over all others. Everything else, which is what is consistent with the first book of Genesis in the Bible, which is much more about dominion. The second one is about stewardship more than anything else. And the second is that he is speaking about the role of experience in many ways, and where from experience, from what will eventually be known as the data that you accumulate, you will eventually be able to come up with a theory. And this is what he will call induction, or which will come to be known as induction or popularly. And the reason his book is called The Novum Organon, or The New Organon, is he's taking on a philosopher, and that philosopher is Aristotle. Right? And Aristotle has written a book called The Organon, right? And so what's interesting is that you are looking at a period of time where you're looking at a span of about 18 centuries, and you're still saying Aristotle's important. In case you think how silly, we still think Aristotle's important, okay? And that's a full 22 centuries. So he's doing this, and he's saying, well, and so he's taking on what he would be considered the more deductive forms that Aristotle would have employed, which is interesting because Aristotle himself was deeply interested in observation, right? And in this sense, he broke with his preceptor, and who was Plato, himself the student of Socrates, right? And so some of you may have seen this famous painting by Raphael, right, who was a contemporary of Michelangelo and of Leonardo, and what you have, and you've got all of these mathematicians and astronomers and philosophers. Euclid, for example, and he used Bramante, the architect, to play Euclid in this regard. But in the center, Plato.
It just doesn't acknowledge that there's a, headset. Maybe it's the jack. I don't know.
I'm quite happy to co-share this.
Shoot. That's right over here.
Come on, hi. This may not be Deus Ex Machina, but it's close. Well, okay. Let's steal this moment while we wait before the next interruption occurs. Okay, so we've got the School of Athens and we've got Aristotle. And so this allows me now to move to another area which is frightfully important in our thinking, and that is the place of philosophy, right? And a book that I absolutely love speaking about is Jostein Gaarder's Sophie's World, right? And why I like this book, and it appeared in the early 90s, the reason I like the book is because someone's actually trying to make philosophy intelligible, right? And he's doing it in a way that where there are characters and characters that you can back. And in this particular case, it's a 16-year-old girl called Sophie Amundsen, right? And suddenly she starts getting letters stuffed in her letterbox. And they're questions like these. Who are you? Where does the world come from? Right? And what it is that it's really a course on philosophy. And so it's this middle-aged chap who's sending these letters to her, stuffing them in through the mediation of his dog, Hermes, and messenger, if you will. And this is what is at the heart of the book. And so it asks questions like these. How was the world created? Is there any will or meaning behind what happens? How can we answer these questions? How ought we to live? And so it's interesting, the whole question of what is, what ought to be, and these are important. So one, the origins of philosophy originate from humankind's sense of wonder, right? The root of the word, philosophia, love, philo, wisdom, sophia. And you divide it into epistemology, logic, metaphysic, logical ethics, aesthetics, how you know what you know. You've probably spoken about elements of these before. And I love this particular quotation. It says, a philosopher never gets quite used to the world. To him or her, the world continues to be a bit unreasonable, bewildering, even enigmatic. Philosophers and small children thus have an important faculty in common. You might say that throughout his life, a philosopher remains as thin-skinned as a child. And so I take a bit of a digression here and move to another book that I absolutely love and which many of you have read, may have read, and that is Le Petit Prince, The Little Prince. And there's a very telling picture over there, right? He's drawn this picture of a boa constrictor consuming an elephant. This is what he writes. He says, I showed my masterpiece to the grown-up and asked them if my drawing frightened them. They answered, why should anyone be frightened by a hat? My drawing did not represent a hat. It was supposed to be a boa constrictor digesting an elephant. So I made another drawing on the inside of the boa constrictor to enable the grown-ups to understand. They always need explanations. My drawing number two looked like this, right? And so here you are. So here's what is important, right? One of the key elements that I'm going to make the case for science is wonder. Question, should it be this way? And I don't know whether you've come to issues of falsification as yet, and you may have, right? And the question is, does a theory hold? Should it hold under all these conditions? If conditions change such that the theory no longer coheres, does it collapse? The answer in all probability is yes. But this is where you ask the questions, and you're asking these questions along the way. And so Sophie's work continues. Is there a basic substance of which everything else is made? Can water turn into wine? How can earth and water produce a live frog? Now, if you want to answer these, read the book. But these are the kinds of questions that are being posed. And so in those early chapters, a significant area to which Garda takes us, the philosopher Alberto Knox takes Sophie, it's first to theology, or perhaps less sophisticatedly, mythology, right? And so you can say, and you've got Thor, for example, you can have. And again, I'd like you to think about how some stories that fall to the cosmogonies of particular countries continue to endure, right? In what you watch, right? And so you have this, right? And so what happens at the beginning? You say, I mean, there's always a sense of there's fear, there's apprehension, there's worship that's emergent as a consequence. And then you say, how do we square this with how we live? Is there a danger of accounting? Is that what's going to happen? So these questions continue. Since some philosophers live in a different age, and perhaps in a completely different culture from ours, it's a good idea to see what each philosopher's project is. One philosopher might want to know how plants and animals came to be. Another might want to know whether there is a god or whether man has an immortal soul. And then he moves to an area which will be the next turn in the lecture as it continues, and that is the place of the natural philosophers. So those who were mainly concerned with the natural world's processes observed that nature was in a constant state of transformation. All the early philosophers shared the belief that there had to be a basic substance at the root of all change. And it so happened the center of such thinking was ancient Greece. Now, you might quibble with this, and we can talk about that in a while, but we're looking at what has actually governed a lot of thinking so far as the modern scientific project is concerned. And so we go here. So here's modern Greece, and there's the ancient Greek world on the right. And this will include places like Ephesus, Phrygia, Miletus, all of which are now in Turkey, right? But you have what's called, what was Hellenistic influence all over that area, okay? And tremendous development was occurring across a number of spheres, such as the theater of Miletus. And this talk was originally supposed to have happened at the OAT, and I would have said, aha, look, like what we are. But you have a sense, this is, you have a notion of the theatron, the scheme, from where we get the words theater and scene, if you will. Now in Miletus, there were, as I say, three Greek philosophers of consequence. And very quickly, one sentence essentially, Thales and Anaximander and Anaximenes, and they respond to that question of, is there a basic substance, right? And a lot of this actually comes through us again through Aristotle. They're like, they're not writing as much as, so there's this oral written chronicle in some sense that's occurring. So Thales believes it's water. Anaximander believes it's something ethereal, the boundless, and that's what he's talking about. Well, Anaximenes believes it's air, right? So these are the people that are coming. There are more Greek philosophers of consequence, and these are people who are now coming, I mean, from what is now recognizable as parts of Greece, in what is still under it. And all the way into Italy in many ways. And so you've got Parmenides, who believes that nature is constant and our senses deceive us. Heraclitus says the opposite. He's saying you can't step into the same river twice, right? There are differences. There are these changes that are occurring. And it's Empedocles who's trying to bring all of this together and says, well, let's think about these substances, water, air, the like, and then he's the one who comes up with the notion of throwing out the four Greek elements of air, fire, earth, and water. Another continuation, we've seen the last airbender, for example, and things like that. It's functionally working off the same principle, right? So there you are. Now, as I did say, the center of the ancient world, but there are equivalents, or at least to some extent, you've got the five Sanskritic or Ayurvedic elements that are Jal, Agni, Prithvi, Vayu, and Akash, right? We've got space as well, right? The Chinese elements, wood, fire, earth, metal, water. And it's significant that you have these similarities across place. Coming back to the four ancient Greek elements, this has a huge impact upon medicine and physiology. How? Look at this. You've got air and fire, hot, right? Wet, air and water. Fire and earth, dry. Water and earth, cold. And so Hippocrates, right? The great physician, Greek. And years later, centuries later, his Roman successor, Galen, would be at the forefront of what is known as humoral theory. And your temperaments were determined by the fluxes, if you will, the liquids that were in your body. So you could be immediately sanguine or choleric or phlegmatic or melancholic. And I remember when I was in college, I had this friend to be with, and we spent a lot of time trying to determine what the temperaments of our friends were. Needless to say, that made us extremely unpopular. But there we are. Okay. So Galen's doing this. And now we're moving to what the impact of humoral theory was. And the answer is considerable. It would last all the way to the 17th century and then some, right? So what Galen is doing is saying, well, there are two types of blood, venous and arterial. There are three body centers, the liver, the heart, and the brain, where the liver is in charge of nutrition and growth, the heart, vitality, and the brain, sensation and reason. Continuing in that line, he says nourishment and growth is secured by venous blood originating in the liver, right? Vitality conveyed to body parts by arterial blood originating in the heart. However, and this is the key thing, since the blood got used up, there's no question of its circulating, right? So here's the problem over here, right? So he says, how do the ingredients of arterial blood, venous blood and air, get into the left ventricle of the heart to be changed into arterial blood? That is from the right side of the heart to the left. And in case you've forgotten, this is what the human heart looks like, right? At least in diagram, you've got what's called the right atrium, the left atrium, the superior vena cava, and the pulmonary artery. And like, so you've seen all this. Now, Galen's trying to get around this problem, right? So he's saying venous blood passed through the right side of the heart to the left through hidden pores in the interventricular septum, right? So you're looking at this particular area, right? So he's saying once in the left ventricle, the blood mixed with the air that was carried by the pulmonary vein. Now you have to think the way he is, right? At that point in time, this mixture of blood and air heated by the heart was subsequently sent via the aorta to the whole organism to provide heat and vital spirit. That's the term that's being used. He did not know of pulmonary movement, that is right to left side by moving through the pulmonary artery to the lungs, the pulmonary vein to the heart. Air was necessary to make arterial blood and got there via the pulmonary vein to the left side of the heart. The result was a mixture of pneuma, what he called spirituous air, and blood in the left ventricle was arterial blood. The pulmonary vein also conducted sooty vapors back to the lungs. Right? So this is the Galenic world. One key element. Dissection was not allowed on human bodies. So one of the things as a historian of science, I'm always gobsmacked in some sense as to how people are reasoning based upon what's available in their time, right? And I think this is, and Galen's pretty smart, right? He's working on animals, all of that is happening. In fact, Galen was both a physician and would also intervene along the way. I mean, and so he was completely dismissive of other people around the time. If any of you have seen the series House, he's just like House, right? I mean, that's someone who completely denigrates everybody who's around him, yet is incredibly good at what he does, right? Now, Galen is not taken uncritically across all time. And from one area, and this is key, it's Arabia, right? And while I'm not going to spend too much time on Arabia or what I would call more generally the Islamicate world, the fact remains that if we're making a great deal about Aristotle today, we owe such a debt of gratitude to the Islamicate world. And I draw the distinction between Islamic and Islamicate. The Islamic world is governed very much by what you call a theology of a kind. While in the Islamicate world, you will have the ruler who is Islamic, but will have a polyglot of languages under command. You will have people of various religions. There would be Jews, there would be Christians, all in this particular world. And so if you consider places like Baghdad or Cordoba, right, or Sevilla in Spain, these are tremendous places where this is occurring. And in fact, Borges, who I mentioned earlier, the Argentinian, writes this book called Averroes Search, where what he's doing is commenting analytically, right, upon Aristotle. And from a theatrical perspective, falls short when he encounters the words comedy and tragedy, because he doesn't know how to translate them. And eventually they say he comes up with panegyric and satire, and then disappears. And this is, and it's a tremendous story by Borges again. And it's this whole question about how far can you translate? How far when you're separated by time and space and culture, right? There's a tremendous book. I mean, the opening is fantastic. It's written by a man called L.P. Hartley. And he wrote, it is called The Go-Betweens. And the lines are used very often. It starts with, the past is a foreign country. They do things differently there. And it's well worth keeping in mind, right? So in Arabia, you had Ibn al-Nafis, who was born in Damascus, and he died in Cairo. He was a physician, sultan, doctor, jurist, theologian, writer. They don't make them like they used to, right? So a possible early describer of pulmonary circulation, the less circulation to the lungs. In his view, blood did not cross the interventricular septum of the heart, which is what they were thinking about earlier, but instead passed through the lungs. For Ibn al-Nafis, there were no pores in the interventricular septum, and the pulmonary vein contained a mixture of blood and air rather than just air, right? Now you move to Europe, and I'm not going to go through the number of people like Aquapendente and Fabricius. There are a number of people. I'm going to go straight to this fairly pugnacious chap whose name was William Harvey. Was born in Kent, studied at Caius College in Cambridge, worked with Sir British Y. Benson, absorbs Aristotelian ideas of observation. Remember the point I made earlier? Okay, relating structure to function, returns to England, joins the Royal College, and writes De Motu Cordis, it's about the movement of the heart, before he dies in Roehampton. Now, again, look at this, 1578 to 1657, and he is now, okay, moving to the 17th century. This is around the time of the Stuarts. Now, Shakespeare was under a dynasty known as the Tudors, right? And so you had Henry VII, Henry VIII, you had Elizabeth I, before that you had Bloody Mary, and the like, okay, so this is good. But over here you've got the Stuarts, and Charles I is the grandson of Mary, Queen of Scots, who had had her head suitably removed from her body by her first cousin once removed under her orders, who was Elizabeth, right? But at the end of it, what happens is that when Elizabeth dies, I mean, it's ironic that Mary's Queen of Scots' son gains her throne, right? And so, and then you have the James VI of Scotland becomes James I of England. And his son is Charles I, and William Harvey is demonstrating circulation because it's happening at this period in time. And I'd like you just to look at the nature of the address where he's making a comparison. He's saying, first of all, to the most illustrious and indomitable Prince Charles, King of Britain, France, and Ireland, defender of the faith. Right? Immediately, the theology is there. Right? Most illustrious prince. The heart of animals is the foundation of their life, the sovereign of everything within them, the sun of their microcosm, that upon which all growth depends, from which all power proceeds. The king, in like manner, is the foundation of his kingdom, the sun of the world around him, the heart of the republic, the fountain whence all power, all grace doth flow. Right? You can see this. If ever you wanted to ingratiate yourself to power, you could do far worse than this. Right? So you can see immediately what he's doing, right? He's looking at patronage. It's ironic, the same king 21 years later would lose his head, right? It is in thanks to Oliver Cromwell, right? And so you have this moment from 1649 to 1660, where you had Cromwellian rule and his successors before Charles II comes back. And so you've got this, you see, I'm more emboldened to present to your majesty the thing, many things in a king are after the pattern of the heart. Then he goes on to make this important confirmation. The heart worked like a muscle with ventricles contracting and expelling blood, systolic contractions, rather than sucking it in, diastolic expansion. The arteries pulsated because the shock wave from the beating heart, rather than of their own intrinsic pulsative virtue. So here's to come back, right? Because there's a lot of stuff over here. He says, how did the ingredients of arterial blood get to the left ventricle to be changed to arterial blood on the right side? And here's Harvey contesting Galen. He says, how can air and sooty vapors be kept distinct in one channel? Right? The pulmonary vein. After all, opening the vein reveals blood alone. Through experiments on simpler organisms, including vivisections, yes, there was a lot of that, that's dissecting live animals, right? Vivisecting, cutting into live animals. By the way, it continued into the 19th century, into part of the 20th, did it? Harvey dramatically showed that blood left the heart per minute so quickly that it could not continually be replaced by blood made in the liver by chyle, a combination of lymph and emulsified fats. So think back to Galen, you're saying, where is that venous blood being sucked in? And he said, the liver. And he's saying, no, this can't happen, right? And so this is what he says. So he says, and these are his words, right? But I should like to be informed why, if the pulmonary vein were destined for the conveyance of air, it has a structure of a blood vessel here. Nature had rather need of annular tubes, such as those of the bronchi, in order that they may always remain open and not be liable to collapse, and that they might continue entirely free from blood, lest the liquid should interfere with the passage of the air, as it so obviously does when the lungs labor from being either greatly oppressed or loaded in a less degree with phlegm, as they are when the breathing is performed with a sibilous or rattling noise, right? And so what he's doing is he's demonstrating, he's undergirding his position with argument, right? And so he's contesting something that's held sway for 18 years. And so you have the circulation of blood. And you know the story in many ways, right? You say deoxygenated blood that will be carried, right, to the lungs. And then it's the only time when the pulmonary artery differs from other arteries in doing that. And likewise, a vein, the pulmonary vein will carry oxygenated blood, unlike all other veins, right? And one of the things he does with ligatures, he performs a simple experiment using ligature to extend the base of the arm. He shows that blood can only be moved in one direction. So all of these are important lessons. Now, I said I was going to use something that's illustrative. And this, for me, is an illustration of a particular kind of revolution, if you choose to call it a revolution, right? And this would be the physiological revolution. But here I started and I said, you're talking about astronomy, right? And you say, and I look at this. So I start with, were there revolutions? And one key element over here is when you think about the French Revolution, for example, it has a decided start and end, right? You have Louis XVI essentially being, first of all, simply becoming citizen Louis. And afterwards, he and his wife, Marie-Antoinette, don't last the guillotine. Right? So you have this, and you know, and then afterwards, but the question is, when you, and they even go ahead and they change the calendar, and you have the words like Brumaire taking over, you're getting rid of this January to December, things like that. This lasts for a while, right? And then what you get? Napoleon. Right? So you have this. It's interesting, but you have this, and you say when Napoleon comes in, you have this dictatorial figure coming in, there is a start and end to this republic and to this particular revolution. Can we say the same thing about other revolutions that aren't political the same way? The Industrial Revolution comes to mind, right? But then again, and Wooten is great, he says, when does it happen? I'm going to look at places like, say, the 1760s, to the 1820s, perhaps to the 40s, right? You're getting machinery coming in. You're getting changes in transportation. You're getting the notion of the factory. Maybe this takes time, but nonetheless, there is a greater bound, but a bound, however. But look at these. I've actually put on dates, right? Copernican Revolution, 16th century, Physiological Revolution, 17th century, the Chemical Revolution, 18th century, the Darwinian Revolution, 19th century, the Germ Theory Revolution, 19th century, the Einsteinian Revolution, 20th century, the Digital Revolution, 20th and 21st, and carrying on. Right? So how do we make sense of this? And how does this help us when we think about these, right? I'm going to show you two things. First, the point of view of their time. Perhaps this will be illustrative, and hopefully I won't lose this, but we'll see. Now, I don't know, in SCR, do you still do Galileo, the play? You do. The play. Okay, it was done at one point in time, not in the year I taught, but another. So the playwright Bertolt Brecht wrote this play called Galileo, right? And I'm just playing a little bit of it, and this is on YouTube, by the way. This is the recently deceased Topol, who was made famous largely because of the work he did in the musical Fiddler on the Roof. He this is his playing Galileo.
A position. On a Tuesday, I looked again. They have changed again. Tell them what you see. Where is the fourth? Do you know this product of 17?
I might just mute this and look at the subtitles, sadly.
But this it's not coming down. Mirror screen.
You try this. Echo coming.
Years of patient research will be on sale tomorrow.
When he's angry,
can't be fixed to anything if there's another star revolving round it. Where are the crystal spheres now that the stars are supposed to be fixed to?
Nowhere. There's no scaffolding in the sky. There's nothing holding the universe up. Don't stand there like a stockfish, as if you are afraid it isn't true.
I'm not standing like a stockfish. I'm trembling because I'm afraid it is true.
Why?
What do you think is going to happen to you when you say that there's another sun with other Earths revolving round it? That this Earth is a planet and not the center of the universe? And that there's nothing but stars? No difference between Earth and heaven. No heaven at all.
Where's God? What do you mean?
So this is a key.
Ouch.
So this is a key question, right? So we're coming back to that issue of theology, right? And this is okay. And so as we're drawing to the end of this lecture, I'd like you to see the connections that we're making, right? This is one, and then I'm going to turn to another, which is a 19th century debate. And that is around the question of evolution, right? And this is a dramatization of a famous debate that occurred in Oxford between Bishop Wilberforce and Thomas Henry Huxley, who was known as Darwin's bulldog. I mean, he's the one, he took up cudgels so much on behalf of Darwin In fact, when he first heard about the theory of natural selection, he said, oh, how uncommonly stupid of me not to have thought of it. Right? And then afterwards, and this is what he said. So let's see what this bit is. And so here's this, if we can hear it. Let's see.
To our natural history from the pen of Mr. Charles Darwin is certain to command attention. His latest publication, The Origin of Species, is manifestly regarded by him as the opus upon which his future fame is to rest. Mr. Darwin claims that every living thing, every fish, plant, fungus, fly, elephant, man, turnip, are all equally the lineal descendants of the same common ancestor. Such a notion is absolutely incompatible with the word of God. Man was made in the image of God and redeemed by the eternal Son. Natural selection is an ingenious theory for denying the working and therefore the existence of the Creator. In fact, the human brain differs markedly from that of all other mammals.
Unfortunately, my Lord Bishop, you have been misinformed. We are unprejudiced judges. We have to admit that there is as little interval as animals between the gorilla and the man as there is between the gorilla and the baboon. It is speech alone and not some spiritual gift that makes man a reasonable being. That is the source of our unlimited intellectual progress, but that does not disguise the fact that to the very root and foundation of his nature, man is one with the rest of the organic world. No one who has ever dissected the brain of an ape agrees with Professor Owen. His findings are wrong. I can only assume that Professor Owen's brain must have shrunk in the pickling jar.
I meant, of course, the chimpanzees' brains he had examined.
Oh, Lord.
It was then that God delivered Wilberforce into my hands.
I wonder, Mr. Huxley, is it through your grandfather or your grandmother that you claim descent from an ape?
I stood up, very quiet, very grave, and said my say with perfect good temper.
If the question is put to me, would I rather have a miserable ape for a grandfather or a man, highly intelligent, possessed of great means of influence, and yet who employed these faculties and that influence for the mere purpose of introducing ridicule into a grave scientific discussion? I unhesitatingly affirm my preference for the ape.
You didn't. I said that, or something very like that.
How dare you attack a live bishop in public? Have you no respect for the purple waistcoat?
Lady Brewster fainted, had to be carried from the room. And then Admiral Fitzroy got to his feet.
Fitzroy? Oh my.
Quickly. Can you hear me? All right. So, who are our dramatis personae in this particular regard? We've got Bishop Samuel Wilberforce, an interesting character, the son of William Wilberforce, who was at the heart of removing the stain of slavery from Great Britain, way before it happened in the United States and before Britain's colonies, there was a bit of hypocrisy there. But Wilberforce tried, that's one thing. So to that end, Wilberforce on the question of slavery and Darwin would have been on the same side, right? So this is one of the things, consider social context. It's not like you're going to disagree upon every variable that there is, right? So that's one thing to keep in mind. But the key question over here is, where is God, right? And this is, and with the Industrial Revolution, with an important element that occurred in the 18th century, and this was in France, when two people who were remarkably atheistic, particularly one person called Denis Diderot and a person called D'Alembert, wrote what was called the Encyclopédie, the encyclopedia, right? These ideas were beginning to come to England. Then you had the French Revolution. Then you said, why is it that God's only on the side of some, right? And so these questions really began to bother societally entire groups of people that had been in thrall, right, in many ways. And so you can see where a lot of the impetus is arising. And I'm making the case over here that science is by no means immune, right? Science is a social activity like any other. And scientists, like other people, are human, right? Right, so I'm coming to this. So we've got our revolutions in science over here, right? Right. Now, you are dealing with Kuhn, aren't you? Okay. In 1962, Thomas Kuhn, he had been a teaching fellow at Harvard, then moved on to Chicago, wrote this very persuasive book called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. So what he was doing was saying that you work within what he called a paradigm. You can do very good work within that paradigm. You can even extend it and be a tremendous scientist. But along the way, moments occur when the observations, the data don't seem to match the theory. And so you need to come up with another explanation. And these are, he calls, revolutions. So there are key elements here. One, he says, you're laboring under a particular set of assumptions. For example, the world has an ether, and you have to account for an ether until you say the ether isn't there. And then you have to do something. That diseases are caused because of effluvia coming from the soil. You have what's called miasma that are emerging. And then you say, steady on, I'm seeing little bodies under the microscope. And how strange, I'm finding them in diseased people as well. There must be a connection. You think about this particular entity that apparently gave off air, and it was called phlogiston. And then you say, well, then three people pop up along the way. One is called Carl Wilhelm Scheler from Sweden, a Brit called Joseph Priestley, who for his political views disappears to the United States because he's essentially drummed out of house and home, but is otherwise a chemist, along, and a man called Antoine Laurent Lavoisier, who collects taxes and also does chemistry. And he's the one who will give to a particular gas that we all know well, the word oxygen which we now know as oxygen. For all, I mean, not for that, but for his tax collecting, even though he was sympathetic to the revolution, he would lose his head too. A lot of people are losing their heads in this talk, aren't they? Yeah, cool. So what Kuhn is saying essentially is that you're laboring under a particular set of ideas in a paradigm, and then you have the revolution, and then you move somewhere else, and these two positions are deemed incommensurable with each other, right? So that's the major change that is occurring. And so because of that, now you say, well, this was then, but we can't hold both at the same time. Now, perhaps he overstated the case in case, and this is Kuhn in many ways, and you say, well, but it certainly had a great deal of purchase in terms, especially of how we think. And so we ask that question about revolutions. My point stands about when these happen and can we really compare this with political or the industrial revolution as the case may be. Now, drawing towards the end, let's ask some certain questions. What was science? Now, the word science, and this is from Wooten again, comes from the Latin scientia, which means knowledge. One view to take is that truth or knowledge is what people think it is. On this view, astrology was once a science, and so, of course, was theology. In medieval universities, the core curriculum consisted of the seven liberal arts. You've heard that word before? Okay. And sciences, grammar, rhetoric, and logic, mathematics, geometry, music, and astronomy, including astrology. They're often now referred to as the seven liberal arts, but each one was originally called an art, which meant a practical skill, and a science, a theoretical system, right? And there was this distinction that's made. So even when the Royal Society was started in 1660, these were people who thought, as opposed to the artisans that made, right? So if you were a doctor, you weren't considered particularly of high repute, as opposed to the place the doctors hold today. So it's interesting to see how those changes occur, right? And you say, so you've got this, these arts and sciences provided students with the later study of philosophy or theology or of medicine or law. These two were called sciences, but philosophy and theology were purely conceptual explorations that lacked an accompanying applied skill. So this is how the word is being used. In fact, you would use, in Greek, you would have the word physis. And so you would have, if you had natura, or nature in Latin, you would have physis in Greek, from which you get physics, physiology, and physician. Right? So think about the hold that these have. And the word scientist appeared in print only as recently as 1834, right? By this philosopher, an Anglican priest called William Whewell. And the reason that he introduced it was because he was reviewing a book on the connection of the physical bodies was written by a woman who, along with Caroline Herschel, William Herschel, remember Uranus, is named an honorary member of the Royal Astronomical Society. And the reason he introduces the word is so that it can be gender neutral, right? You know, the words before were men of science, but scientist takes out that. And so there were some people who wanted to have nothing to do with it, said this is a bastardized word. Why? Because you're linking Greek and Latin, right? So you're saying one part of it is from Latin. So he said, this is unholy. And so it's interesting that you get these actually coming together. Mary Somerville, and this is an interesting point. There is a college in Oxford, and it's called Somerville College. And two of the people that did the first version of SCR from Krea went there. One is called Nayan Rajesh, who was there last year, and Rutuja Rokhde, who's there right now, right? And so there is a Krea connection. So yeah. And yeah. So now when finishing on perhaps something of a philosophical note. recently deceased, there was a sociologist of science called Bruno Latour, and he wrote this book called Nous n'avons jamais été modernes, or We Have Never Been Modern. And this is what he writes. He says, and this is looking at, when we talk about modern science, let's think about modernity itself. And he says, modern is doubly asymmetrical. It designates a break in the regular passage of time, and it designates a combat in which there are victors and vanquished. If so many of our contemporaries are reluctant to use this adjective today, if we qualify it with prepositions, it is because we feel less confident in our ability to maintain that double asymmetry. We can no longer point at time's irreversible arrow, nor can we award a prize to the winners. In the countless quarrels between ancients and moderns, the former come out winners as often as the latter now. And nothing allows us to say whether revolutions finish off the old regimes or bring them to fruition. Hence the skepticism that is oddly called postmodern, even though it does not know whether or not it is capable of taking over from the moderns, right? And so he goes on. And one of these moments, a sense of unease with the Industrial Revolution and the theory of natural selection would come through in poetry. And there is this very powerful poem that some of you may know, and it's called Dover Beach, written by Mathew Arnold. And I draw your attention to the last lines, right? And it says, ah, love, let us be true to one another for the world which seems to lie before us like a land of dreams, so various, so beautiful, so new, has really neither joy, nor love, nor light, nor certitude, nor peace, nor help for pain. And we are here as on a darkling plain, swept with confused alarms of struggle and blood, where ignorant armies clash by night. And you can see immediately the sense of loss, of anomie, which is occurring where the reassurance of religion in many ways has suddenly gone out of the window. What are some of the points to which I will draw your attention as we close? One, where has science gone? And one of the points, some of you may have seen the movie Oppenheimer, for example, and there are major philosophical questions that arise over there. I draw my illustration for something a little further back, where people called Glidden Knot would say, using craniometry and the like, you can actually start categorizing people. And you can speak about those that are of less intelligence. You can speak of those that are of a criminal bent, right? Now, would this be deemed science in its time? And a great popularizer of science with whom I had the great privilege of working, Stephen Jay Gould, wrote a book called The Mismeasure of Man, where he actually looked at elements like these and came all the way to look at IQ tests. And we speak about eugenics and its long shadow over so much of the 20th century. Finally, in the mid-1990s, you had a cloned sheep, Dolly, right? So Ian Wilmot did this, managed to get Dolly to happen after many moments of lack of success, right? And you had an adult ghost cell, essentially, which was used to, into which you would put genetic material, which eventually would result in the formation of Dolly. Dolly died, but she had offspring, yeah. But not before she had offspring, yeah. But she died sooner than they imagined. Now, one of the major issues was, are people beginning to play God, right? And so one place where this really came to the fore was in fiction. And the writer is a Nobel laureate. His name is Kazuo Ishiguro. And he wrote a book called Never Let Me Go, right? And this is the last time when I will have to go through this. See. Okay. Can you see this? Oh, fancy that. Okay, this is the trailer of Never Let Me Go, hopefully it'll work.
My name is Kathy H. I'm 28 years old. I now spend most of my time not looking forwards, but looking back on what happened to us at Hailsham.
Catch it, Tommy!
Why didn't Tommy get the ball?
There was once a boy who had ran off beyond the boundary. They found him in the woods, with his hands and feet cut off.
Who told you these stories?
Everybody knows them.
And how do you know they're true?
You'd make up stories as horrible as that.
Students of Hailsham are special.
Yes, we said
keeping yourselves well, keeping yourselves healthy inside, is of paramount importance.
None of you will do anything except live the life that has already been set out for you. And sometime around your third donation, your short life will be complete. That's what you're created to do.
We were moved from Hailsham at 18. Tommy, Ruth and I.
Exactly how much experience have you guys had with the outside?
Quite a lot.
We haven't.
Drinks?
5 Cokes, please. If there was a boy and a girl, and they were properly in love and they could prove it, then they would be given a few years together before they began their donations.
Why do you do that thing, squeezing Tommy's shoulder?
I'm allowed to touch Tommy, aren't I?
It's the way you're touching him.
Suppose for a second that there is a special arrangement for Hailsham students if they're in love.
Although Tommy really likes you as a friend, he just doesn't see you that way.
We are modelled on trash.
We're in love. It's true love. It's verifiable.
We didn't have to look into your souls. We had to see if you had souls at all. I wish I could help you. You poor creatures.
Maybe none of us really understand what we've lived through, or feel we've had enough time.
It's essentially based upon clones, and the reason they've been brought into existence is so that when their prototypes have something go wrong with a disease, their organs are given over. And the term used is that they complete, and that's the euphemism for when they die. But what happens when the clones fall in love? What happens when the clones become friends? What happens to them? And this is the ethical question in some ways that's largely being raised by one of the foremost novelists of our time. So let me leave it at that and conclude by saying this. The history of science, above all, speaks to the interconnectedness of humanity. Science is not hermetically sealed, it is inevitably constructed, and that construction forms the societies whose values and morals shape it and from which its practitioners as scientists are drawn. That also means, however, that such constructions can be plural in scope, and ultimately, in that fact, lie both our excesses and our redemption. Thank you.
Thank you so much, John. We have time for a few questions, if anybody is has any questions?
Can I take me over there? Sit right there.
Should I take? Oh.
Okay. Seeing like how science has developed throughout the ages, because people give. Can you hear it? No.
Go ahead.
Yeah, the development of science. You know, science is a little process that happens in a day. So, because Rome wasn't built in a day, that's what it basically means. But you'll see a trend in modern era with the advent of social media and the people always being active and reading papers, actually reading scientific papers these days, which is the layman becoming more and more impatient with scientists in the modern era. Like a person wanting results almost instantly. Like paleontology is a thing that suffers from this because a species or a specimen called Spinosaurus aegypticus, it's something which has been debated and reclassified time and time again, and people defining such a multicellular organism on such a big scale. Like you're basically defining a creature which was twice the size of an elephant into classifying it as a biped, then a quadruped, then something which swims. So people are like, why can't a scientist basically make up their mind? Why do you need to change constantly? And I think this is the biggest flaw of this era, basically, not giving the scientists enough time to describe what they want to. It's like saying if Galen was on a time limit, or if Galen's entire process was streamed on Twitch or something. Like if people are not given enough time, or if the funding is cut off because people don't think their research is malleable enough, or if it's not interesting enough anymore. Like if you're changing your mind this much, then what's even the point of it all? And I think that is a big precaution for all of us to take. Like, to be patient with things, even if a research takes like a decade or two, or 2 decades, or maybe not in our lifetimes, I think we should let that be and not be impatient with people and say like, come on, just finish the research, finish this era, finish everything.
Okay, thank you.
Can you hear me? Right, thank you. That's a very thoughtful point. One of the major issues, and this is because if you think about it, the number of journals has quadrupled and more in the 20th century alone, right? And there's been a great deal more of specialization, right? You can't get the kind of description that you saw Harvey give, although it was lovely, right? The way it was written. It can't be framed that way. The issue is always funding, right? And so you're going to say, if we have limited funds, how do we support particular kinds of work? And sadly, it becomes an issue of utility very often. So is one major example of this was during the Cold War, how MIT was getting a great deal of funding from the US government, right? And was called, and at that time was called the military industrial complex. And so because it was seen as important for the nation in many ways. What would it be possible to do that work for another example of herbivorous sauropods, for example? It's tough to make that claim. I mean, there were major competitions between a person called two people called Cope and Marsh in the 19th century to try and get dinosaur bones. But is it possible to do that still? And the issue and the question is perhaps not as much. I worked in a laboratory in the States where we're trying to look at the phylogeny of a group of carnivorous butterflies or carnivorous caterpillars. And again, you were trying to see from where you could get the funding. People would say, one more specimen of something that is this completely dull, small little critter. Why? You know, and so I'm with you, but that always becomes a critical. Other questions? Yeah.
Yeah.
So Professor, I personally read a lot of Aristotle. So it's a personal belief of mine that the concept of neuroscience could be developed from the very central theme of Socratic philosophy, which is why is man and what is the ideal man? I believe that Socrates, then Plato and Aristotle, all of them have tried to answer this question by looking into themselves and discussing how the human mind functions and what the ideal and most efficient way of function a human mind can have. So if you would like to confirm my
Remember, you can always read a great deal into Plato and Aristotle in order to affirm positions that you have. I think the key issue over here is if I were talking about the whole notion of the idea, I would sooner put my money on Plato than Aristotle in this particular regard, because Plato was much more about the idea, right? And Aristotle is breaking with Plato in that particular regard. Aristotle also isn't dissecting, right? So it would be a brave decision in many ways to do that, but I dare say you can draw upon antecedent, and where this happens is because Aristotle was such an extraordinary classifier in his time. So that, yes.
So we'll have time for one more question, but if anybody wants to stay on, I'm sure that John will be happy to speak. Then the people who need to go can go. We can take the.
So one thing that I got from your lecture was that in the evolution of science, it's not just the evolution of our ideas, our answers, but also the evolution in the way we approach science. So it's easy for me to imagine the future of science, how the answers we have today are wrong and how that might be updated. But I'm struggling to imagine what the future of our approaches to science would be. So given your understanding of the history of the development of our approaches to science, do you have any criticisms for the way we do it today? And do you have an imagined idea of what our approach to science would be in the future?
It's an interesting question. I think in some senses, I wonder, and this is I've often wondered whether cognitively we can keep up with the pace of technologies that are emergent from what we are doing. And I do think that science is very tethered in the sense to society. And so the question, of course, is what is it that society at this point in time wants to see? What does your generation want to see in many ways? And I think that there's that on the one hand, and the other crucial elements, and this is to do with the nation state. And I wonder whether the nation state will be able to last much longer, especially when you have major concerns like climate change, right? And you're saying, even if you identify the problem, even if you say these are potential solutions, even if in Glasgow you say, GOP, when you say this is what we should be doing, we should keep climate change rise no more than 1.5 degrees Celsius, is it happening? So can we even begin to ask that question as a planet, right? When there are such strong poles at the level of the nation state. And even the nation state is not a monolith, right? It's a few people that are making those calls for the majority. So the future of science is going to need to be tethered very much to those considerations.
Let's thank John again, and
thank you very much. Thank you for having me. Looks like it. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. And we want, oh, I think Ruchija.
Very powerful on. Thank you so much.
I think Ruchija had a question. Yeah. Ruchija, are you still there? And did you have a question?
I had a question, John, yes.
Hello. Okay.
Can you hear me?
Hello. Yeah.
I had a question. Yeah, I had a question, John.
Go ahead, Ruchija.
Yes. Thank you for this wonderful talk, John, on the history of science panacea, if I may say. I was curious to know where you would place the history of.
I can't hear you. Forgive me. One sec. Go ahead. You were curious about what?
I was curious as to where you would place the history of physiology. Would it be under history of science or medicine? Given that in medicine we disproportionately study diseases more.
I would still place it there. If you're going by the original sense of what the sciences are, when we say that it could, you go on to study medicine, where it would have both a conceptual and an applied aspect, which was the point that I had made at the beginning, right, which Wotan is making in many ways. Remember that the whole notion of the division of the history of science and medicine becomes a largely 20th century preoccupation, starting with George Sarton in 1917, right? So it would be, so this would be looking back at that moment in time. But if you're looking at just the question of a revolution and a change from that perspective, I would say yes, in the larger history of the history of science, it would be that, in that case. Sure.
Yeah, that helps. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for being there. Take care. Bye-bye.